James Hogue was a fantasist and a liar who was also an excellent long-distance runner and ended up becoming a homeless person, a drifter, living in a storage shed with no windows in Utah when he decided to make himself up, to invent himself anew and become a new person. And he applied to Harvard and Princeton and Stanford, the most prestigious universities in America, with this incredible story of having taught himself to read Plato under the stars and running through the desert canyons barefoot, the ideal of what American universities wanted to imagine that they were, these democratic institutions that accepted the most extraordinary people from all over the United States, and gifted them with a ticket to the upper reaches of American society, a golden ticket. He got that ticket. He got straight A's at Princeton. He was accepted into the most high-class social clubs. He was a champion runner until one day someone who knew him from his former life, or one of his former lives, recognized him. Princeton then had him arrested. He was put on trial. He was sent to prison. The new life he was trying to make for himself was destroyed, and he went back to being a drifter and a thief. The reason the story interested me is that James Hogue was a great American character in a classic mode, the person who invents himself. This is the birthright of every American, except the result for him was something very different. He went to prison. And it wasn't just him. At the time that I wrote this story, there was a whole flurry of cases like this, all of which took place at prestigious American universities, of people from, you know, the lower levels of society making up these identities for themselves and then being uncovered and being thrown out. And this struck me as a very un-American story, since it was not about mobility and self-invention, but it was about punishment. And so I wanted to understand what the story meant. I came to this story because there was a moment where a number of these cases took place, and each one would become a story in the newspapers. And the thing that they had in common was all the stories were presented as though they were going to be light and amusing. Here's someone who pretended he was a Rothschild, and here's, you know, the story of his imposture, and he bought caviar and flowers for all the ladies, and then he ran up big charges on his credit card and he was discovered and da 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 da. Except all of the stories would end badly. The person's life was destroyed, they were put in prison, and instead of a feeling of amusement at the end, all of them made me feel very, very sad. And what I came to realize as I reported the story was that a new society, a new form of social organization was being born in America, and that it had a name. The name was meritocracy, and the word meritocracy was an attempt to explain how to reconcile the traditional American belief in self-invention and social mobility and making yourself up from scratch and democracy with the fact that social mobility in America had come to a halt. I wanted to understand who the person was, and I set out across America to find him. I did find him. We spent a lot of time together. And of course, one of the things that I discovered was that he wasn't the Steven Spielberg Hollywood movie hero that I imagined. He was a liar. He was a good liar. But he was also a person who lied to everyone in his life. Before he applied to Princeton, at Princeton, and after he left. And so I was left with something that became a literary text, because it wasn't simple. This is the one indigenous original American literary form. It's the only form of literature that Americans invented. It's the encounter, the collision of literature and life. It's using the techniques of great literature and the personal voice to explain real things that are happening in a society right now, whether those are large-scale social disruptions or whether they are the kinds of more intimate disruptions that I like to chronicle. The best American literature of the last 50 years, the work of Norman Mailer, Tom Wolfe, Joan Didion, Hunter Thompson, all of these writers, Truman Capote's In Cold Blood, classic American books have been written in this form because it answers very American questions. Who are we? What are we doing here? What's the meaning of this country now? How do you apply the words and the Bill of Rights and the U.S. Constitution to social reality now? These questions are becoming urgent in Europe now, too, in a way that they haven't been before. What is a nation? Are we French? What is France? What's our relation to Europe, to our own values, to universal values? What do we do with the migrants who are landing on our shores? What do we do with people who are citizens of France, but who look and behave and speak very differently and eat different food than the people who live here? That's why this form is not just, this is a good story, I'm glad I wrote it, but I want French people to understand this form of literature because it's great American literature, and it also does things that are very important for this society right now. This is something that the French can use and should use to take literature into the streets and into people's homes and write with the urgency that the questions facing this society deserve.